what you want, when you want it, where you want it. This is The Mesh.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to episode 4, volume 2 of Big Fan, the special Valentine Day edition for all you lovers out there.
Hey, baby.
I'm Chad East, and I'm a big fan of Dolly Parton at the Grammys, festivals not called the Fire Festival, and vans with stripper poles.
Wow. I don't think I can do very much better than that, but my name's Hank Eimer, and I'm a big fan of spring weather at the beginning of February. Watching little kids get crossed up, and surprise videos of your co-host dancing at a charity event.
Hey, I hear they're everywhere these days, Hank.
They are.
Everywhere. Hey, buddy, good to see you on February 12th.
Yes.
Okay, coming to you live here from the Mesh Studios in beautiful downtown Hickory, North Carolina. It's live now when these people hear it.
They're going to hear it recorded. Yes.
But right now it's live. And we actually just encountered something really, really cool. A star from Hickory.
Yeah.
We just ran into him here at the Mesh Studio. He was doing his funny stuff that he does, Mr. John Reap.
Funny dude.
Yeah, real funny dude. Look forward to some big, exciting things from John Reap here in the future, I would guess.
Yep.
If he's at the Mesh Studios, then you know he's doing some cool, exciting
things. Up and coming,
absolutely, no doubt about it. Well, Hank, like I mentioned, we're coming to you in February, 2 days before Valentine's Day, and we've all talked about your hatred for Valentine's Day.
Yeah, I'm not a fan.
Let's go back in time if we can, though, Hank, and let's try to remember a time where Valentine's Day was special to you before your heart became a lump of coal.
Special or stressful?
Well, give me a fun Valentine story. Stressful, special, whatever it may be.
Well, I remember one time I had chicken pox.
Oh, God.
All right? I had chicken pox, and I was at home, and I think I was a junior at this time. And, you know, there's no planning when it comes to Valentine's Day when you're a 16-year-old kid.
Sure.
So you had to buy flowers for a girl. You had to call it, like, 11, right?
Right.
When they're already booked to the hilt.
Sure.
So you call it like 11. You're like, sir, I'm coughing up a lung. I'm dying, you know?
Yes.
I'm like, I need to buy some roses and have them delivered to Hickory High School. And they're like, yeah, right. We're going to jack this one up. Right? So the same roses that were $6.45 a month earlier cost $70.
Absolutely.
Do you know how much bartering I had to do with my parents? See, I'd be like, listen, I'm getting ready to do work for you for months.
Yes.
Just help me out here.
Yeah, I would typically go more of the cheap route. I'm the kind of guy that would go to the convenience store and buy those single roses. You know, you could grab them for about $1.63. Yeah, I was famous for that. So,
now, you know what's funny? That's the same trick you play on Christmas. You know, you say you go to CVS, last minute.
Walgreens. But I do. So I was kind of born a romantic, if you will, Hank. So even since I was little, I always had this feeling of when I got a girlfriend, if I went on a date, I wanted it to be so special. So this is the cheesiest thing I've ever done, but I did it all through high school, which is awful. So when I'd go out on a first date with a girl, I would make sure that the car has got to be just impeccable, right? Clean as
detailed.
A whistle. Very detailed. So I'd clean it all up Saturday, because the way in Hickory things would work, Friday, you hang out with the homeboys.
Yep.
Saturday, that's date night in Hickory. That's how it went from when I was a freshman in high school throughout the years. Was it the same when you came up through high school? Do y'all do the same thing?
Yeah. I mean, I know you guys like had horse and buggy, but you know, back when we did it, it was the same exact way.
Whatever. And so anyway, I'd get the car all cleaned up. Me and Hunter and Will, we'd all meet on Saturday and Roger 10 in the afternoon or in the morning, clean it up, hang out all day, and then we'd go get ready for the dates around 4 o'clock in the afternoon. And on my way home, I'd always stop by Honey Pick and pick up that single red rose.
Romantic.
So romantic. All right, pick the girl up, go to the door, of course, open the car door, I would always have like Keith Sweat or something really R&B, very sexy song playing.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Oh, always.
Yeah. Always.
Always. Open the door.
Girl.
Hey, baby, come on in. Come on in and check it out. Had this little lambskin seat back cushions that were the cheesiest things ever. I fluff them up. Get them all nice and fluffy so that when they sat in there, it felt like they were sitting on a cushion of clouds.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah, yeah, girl. You know what I'm talking about, baby? So anyway, that's kind of how I remember.
Was your car like, up to it? Because, you know, I used to roll in some rough stuff my first car, man. I think that's so funny how when you turn 16, you can be rolling on trash. And you think that your stuff does not stink.
Absolutely.
I remember the first car I ever drove was a Cavalier convertible. The top.
You had a convertible?
Oh, dang, listen. The top had 45 holes in it. It smelled like mildew in there. And if you wanted to put the top down, you had to stick your fingers in the dash and about electrocute yourself. It was awful. But you know what? I own that thing.
Hey, you had wheels, brother. You were getting to from here to there. I had a Carolina Blue, which I hated the color, 1982 Ford Tempo two-door sedan. And the seat sat so far down. I'm a kind of a little fella. It sat so far down, I could barely see over the top, see over the dashboard.
Yep.
So that's one reason I had the lambskin seat cover, because it gave me another like little inch so I could actually peer over the dashboard.
You didn't have to put like books?
No books underneath there. No, that's just all a myth. You know, it's what do they call that when it's not really – You know what I'm talking about? Wives' tale. Thank you. Yes. So, Hank, you know, since we're starting here with our best Valentine's Day ever, which you don't seem to have many, and I had a few, let's move right into what Valentine's Day is about now. It's about a good movie, and more specifically, a good rom-com. And over the last 10 to 15 years, Hank, we've encountered many a good rom-com. I know you have your top five. I've got my top five, too. But let me just give you a couple that didn't make my top five list that might be on someone else's. The movie Say Anything, an exciting movie about love. And everyone remembers the scene where John Cusack is outside the window with the song playing by Peter Gabriel. I can't remember what the name of the song is. But do you remember what I'm talking about? He's got the jam box out there. Another one that didn't quite make my list, The Wedding Singer. You know, Adam Sandler trying to make it as a wedding singer meets Drew Barrymore. You know, he can't quite make it over the top with his band, but he does fall in love. Got a couple other ones that you really like, Hank?
You know, some of those, like My Big Fat Greek Wedding.
Absolutely.
Had a big following.
Got him on my list, yeah. That just missed.
Yeah, that's kind of one. And then, you know, you've got a couple old ones that are all identical, and you can't believe that you can't pick them both, but like Sleepless in Seattle.
Yes.
You know, and there's other ones on there that might be on your list that are like that one. So they didn't make my
list. What was the common denominator? Like in the Sleepless in Seattle, if you remember, there was one like You've Got Mail. Tom Hanks was in a bunch of these rom-coms from like 1988 to 1994, let's say.
So was what was the chick in Sleepless in Seattle?
Meg Ryan. So she was in another one. I wouldn't consider this a rom-com, but it was when she was drunk. When a man loves a woman. That movie. Remember, she was the love interest of Andy Garcia. It was more of a depressing tale rather than a comedy, but she was in that as well. I'm going to give you a couple more that go – or. Flashbacks from way back in the day, 16 Candles.
Yeah, that's
would
a good
you,
one.
You know what I'm saying? I would consider that a rom-com. You know, you got the boy and the girl. It's a funny movie, and they fall in love at the end. But now, Hank, let's start with our top five, okay? Right. Go ahead, and you start us off with number five, if you will.
Number five on mine? I see, the rom-com, I don't care about the rom. I like the comedy.
Yes,
right?
Okay, got it.
So number five for me, Forgetting Sarah Marshall. I thought that was hilarious.
Yes. So I've not seen that movie in its entirety, but I did check out the top 100 rom-com movies listed, and Forgetting, it was number 10.
Really?
So the whole world loves this movie as a rom-com.
Yeah.
Good choice. I came in number 5, and this is a little bit different, but I chose the movie Boomerang. All right, so Boomerang,
I like Boomerang.
You know what I'm saying? Boomerang's a great movie. It was maybe not as comedy field, but you did have Eddie Murphy in it. You did have Martin Lawrence. You had Halle Berry. I mean, good gracious. Yeah, Halle Berry, maybe her first movie, you know, when before she really made it big.
Gosh,
Eddie,
she's hot.
Eddie Murphy's love interest in that movie, Boomerang, comes in at number 5. And if you guys don't have it, get the soundtrack for Boomerang 1992. You won't be disappointed.
That was it?
Yep. 4, Hank.
My 4 is When Harry Met Sally.
Love it.
I like, you know, it's one of the old ones. It's probably, I mean, it's just a good movie.
Yes.
But, it, you know, that's the one that kind of mirrors Sleepless in Seattle. It's all, that's the only, romantic movie that I probably have in my whole one.
To be honest, I think When Harry Met Sally, which we'll talk about here in my list, a little bit higher up, if you will, was the first romantic comedy. In my opinion, that's what I believe. Number 4 for me is, you know, this is off of the beaten path. You would put this as probably your top 4 comedy movie of all time. I'm going Wedding Crashers, and this is the romantic part of it. You know, it's all about he and that girl trying to get together at the end.
Yeah.
And you know what I'm saying?
Yep.
I'm going number 4, Wedding Crashers.
I dig that. I mean, I think that's not a bad choice you made there. My number 3, isn't that what we're on, number 3?
Number 3.
All right, my number 3 is 40-Year-Old Virgin.
Okay, yes. Right. I didn't even think about that one as being one, but yes, it fits the criteria.
Right, right.
I did. Is that the movie where Steve Carell was sitting down and he got waxed
and he yells Kelly Clarkson?
I heard some inside information regarding that. He actually really got waxed in real life,
right.
And the person that did it was not a real professional. Like, not saying she was off the street, but it might have been just one of the extras.
Right.
When she ripped off around his nipple, it almost took his nipple off.
That would not
be the worst thing ever.
Ever.
Oh, God. So no wonder he said Kelly Clarkson out real loud. My number 3 is another oldie but goodie, but man, you wouldn't think about this when you think about rom-coms, but Coming to America. Think about this. He left Africa to find his true love, and the whole movie was about him finding her at McDowell's or McDougal's or whatever it was called. McDowell's. Thank you.
What was the
name of the big house?
The Big Mick.
Thank you very much. That movie, you know, they're coming out with a Coming to America 2 in 2020.
It'll suck.
It can't be as good as the original. Number 3 for me, Coming to America.
Coming to America. That's a great pick. Do you know which one? I've only seen it one time, and I liked it, but you know, it's not like a historically good. Have you ever seen Friends with Benefits?
Ashton Kutcher?
No, it's
Justin Timberlake.
Justin Timberlake.
Yes,
that's a pretty good one. I'll say that one's in there.
Okay.
Now, I mean, didn't make the list, but yeah. I was just sitting there thinking about, you know, ones that may be able to do it. My next one that I would say would be on there is Something About Mary.
Yes, fabulous movie, fabulous movie. Because that movie, its main focus is Mary and the dude trying to win her affection.
Yep.
Yep. I'm going to go a little bit more. My last 3 have been kind of like Wedding Crasher, Coming to America, Boomerang with Eddie Murphy, all these funny people in
right.
it. This one's a little bit more serious, but this one actually, I saw at the movie theater and I went back 3 times. This is embarrassing, but it was Pretty Woman, right? With Richard Gere and Julia Roberts. Why are you looking at me like that?
Because it was a good movie, but I mean,
3 times, buddy. I can remember I was in 8th grade when it came out. And I don't know, there was something about that movie that I just loved. Granted, I was on a date. You know, I take the girl that I was going with to the movie to go see Pretty Woman. So that was my excuse. Hey, she really wanted to see it. Where deep inside, I wanted to see it.
Deep inside.
Coming into number 2, Pretty Woman.
That's unfortunate. I've learned quite a bit about you tonight or today live down here. but I would say my number 1 is from your list, and it's Coming to America.
Oh,
I mean, what kind of
wow?
I mean, that's the comedy is through the roof, and he's doing it for love. Of course, it's going to be the rom com,
yes.
Right? But Eddie Murphy, when he sings out on the street, and they're telling him to shut up.
Yes.
I mean, come on.
Do you remember what was the band?
To be loved.
Yes,
that was great.
And how about Sexual Chocolate? Sexual Chocolate comes out there. Arsenio Hall, he was in that movie too. Just a great, great movie. My number 1, you already mentioned it as your number 4, is When Harry Met Sally. And the reason this movie moved me, Hank. I would actually put When Harry Met Sally in my top 10 of all time movies, not just rom coms. It comes in at number 1 for me. From the beginning to the end, it just was a fabulous movie about friendship, about heartache, and in the end, about love, Hank. About love. Did you say you like that pause right there for effect? I didn't.
You had an effect
love,
on me.
About love, yes, yes.
Yep.
So that wraps up our rom-com top five movies for Valentine's Day. Okay, all you lovers out there, you go rent these on Netflix, whatever you have to do. And then, you know, after the movies and you're feeling all excited and just go on and get in the bed. Right, Hank?
Goodness. We got a weird turn over here real quick.
Oh, yes.
Are we almost done? Oh, I need to get out of this room.
I think it's a wrap. We were talking about earlier in our big fan segment, our top three big fan, whatever we do. You mentioned the Grammys. I mentioned Dolly Parton, and I know you wanted to talk about the Grammys a little bit. Tell me, there were some great performances, right? Did one stand out amongst the rest? What can you take from this Grammys?
Everything I kind of read about it is it kind of stunk. Like everybody's saying it kind of stunk. You know,
did you watch it?
I did. I watched, you know, bits and pieces of it. I wasn't sitting down and watching it, but I watched bits and pieces of it. I think the, you know, when, who's the host?
Alicia Keys.
When Alicia sat down and did her.
Phenomenal.
Yeah, when she did it on both pianos, that was pretty good. I thought that was probably pretty good.
How can you not love? She is like the sweetest, most. You know, when you look at her, she just looks like she's full of love and heart and just as sweet as can be.
Right.
Sweet as can.
And that was a good part. You know, I don't listen to country, but hammered it was that Kacey Musgraves.
Good. That's who I have her on my list as the number one performance of the night.
Yeah,
she was awesome.
Yeah, she was pretty good. Yeah. And you know, I thought Lady Gaga stunk it up.
I didn't really like that performance.
I didn't either. And those two other country guys that sang, he was doing the piano and the other guy was doing the tequila.
Dan and Shay. Yeah.
Yeah, tequila, that was okay.
Yeah.
But I mean, I think that the Alicia Keys and I think that Kacey Musgraves girl, I mean, I don't listen to country, but I might start watching her.
That album, so because of the Grammys, I didn't know any of her songs, so I downloaded a few. That whole album is great, so check it out. There was also a performance by someone named Brandi Carlile. I don't know if you know, she was a folk singer. She sang this song called The Joke. Number two performance, great. Then a performer by the name of Her.
Yep, saw that.
She reminded me of Prince. And then the Monet girl, you know, her performance was great. She reminded me of Prince, too. Shoot, they all remind me of Prince because the performance was really, really good. The performance I did not like was Post Malone and the Red Hot Chili Peppers. I liked the Chili Peppers. Post Malone, I thought he'd be better. Was not very good.
I didn't like Travis Scott. That thing stunk.
I didn't even watch that one.
Yeah, it was not good.
But Dolly Parton. Gave a good performance.
She's like 73 years old.
She looks awesome.
She looks like a handbag is what she looks like. I mean, that stuff is tight.
Yes, it is. You know who really sucked? And I hate to say this because her body is fantastic. But Katy Perry, I think she's forgotten how to sing. Did you see her up there? She couldn't hold a note. She looked like she was trying to dominate the stage. Dolly's up there with her and Kacey Musgraves on the other side doing just perfectly. Well, Katy Perry's trying to do all this dancing and all this stuff to take away from Dolly. Come on, Katie, just sing. Well, I know you didn't because you can't sing anymore.
Oof.
What's wrong with you?
Putting her on Front Street.
I'm telling you, man, I was not impressed. Any surprises here for the Grammys of the award? Oh, Childish Gambino. He won for Record and Song of the Year. This is America.
Yeah.
Right? And that's that song we played a couple podcasts ago. You like Childish Gambino?
Yeah, I like him. I think that you know, he uses his platform for statements, you know, which is his ability to do it. I didn't like Drake coming out and, you know, dissing the Grammys.
Did he?
Yeah. His whole speech was about it. Like how, this trophy doesn't mean you're a good artist. So don't think that, you know, when you have kids in the crowd singing your songs and in your hometown, he's like, it's not a level playing field. And we got people that have their own opinions and agendas judging us. Mm-hmm. And at the end of, you know, it's not like a sport where you hold up a trophy because you want it. It's just, I'm looking at an executive in the back who likes me.
Right.
So, I mean, you know, just take your award.
Thank you. Be gracious.
Take your award.
Yeah. Get off the stage. You like Drake? You look like a Drake fan. I know you used to be a big Drake fan.
Listen, I like some of his music.
Yeah.
But, you know, I mean, there's some artists that are talented that their views overshadow what they do. Like, I do not like Kanye West.
Me either.
I do not like him. I think he is so full of himself, and he ruins any talent that he has.
Mm-hmm.
You know? I mean, the fact that, like, when he jumped on stage in front of Taylor Swift, and, I mean, all that stuff, it's just, come on.
Yeah.
You're taking yourself too serious.
Lighten up.
Lighten up.
Lighten up, buttercup.
And I think Drake's going down that road.
Yeah, think they're too big for their britches now. You know what I'm saying? They got this big head.
They got talent.
Inflated head. Very talented, but hey, inflated head.
You know Jay-Z. You know, you don't, you're not ruling other. You can sing. You prove that. Mm-hmm.
Don't you do it.
Don't
you
because
dare.
I like, you know, I mean, but it's like Kanye. Kanye's a good artist. And I'm not going to take that one. I'm buying any of his records.
Never. So overall, the year 2018 in music, would you say it was a good year? Let's rank it from an A to an F. What are you giving the year 2018?
Well, I think every music's different. Like, I mean, it might have been an A in country, but it might have been a D in rock. Yeah. You know, I think it was a bad year for rap.
Yeah. I mean, Drake won best. He's for that song, you know, whatever one that.
God's Plan.
Yes.
Well, you know, I mean, there's all that. Like, I like J. Cole, and I don't know if we've ever talked about him, but he like raps like real.
Yes.
And he was kind of even made a song that's called 1985, and it talks about how everybody that's rapping right now is on a trend, and you're not rapping from your heart. You're just trying to get on the radio. And he was like, that all is going to stop. And the people that are listening to you, the 14, 15, 16 year olds, they're going to realize you're crap.
Right.
And that isn't going to work. Mm-hmm. And that's all that came out this year.
Yeah.
And so I think that that's part of the problem.
Maybe I need to listen to a little J. Cole.
He's good.
Sounds like he probably would be worth listening to.
Hi, I'm Alan.
I'm Chris.
And we're the co-host of Foot Candle Films, a movie review and film discussion show here on TheMesh.TV.
Each episode, we talk about some new movies, cover some film news, and have some recommendations.
And trust us, we're just as likely to talk about the latest Jim Jarmusch film as we are the newest Transformers installment.
Hold on, don't get too crazy.
Okay, maybe not that bad. But you can find our show and all our episodes on TheMesh.TV. Plus, you can subscribe to get new episodes delivered right to your computer or mobile device.
We'll see you in the ticket line.
Staying on the music tip, so you know this pseudo band that I'm in, right?
It's pseudo, all right.
Yes, which we haven't practiced in probably 6 months. We haven't had a gig in longer.
Do you think that's an indication of your success at a bar? I'm just saying, I mean, you know, when people aren't calling you back and banging down the door. Hey, hold on, Moose, do people call you all the time and ask you to play? All the time. He's got a band.
Well, Moose promotes his
he
band.
Have to. I've heard his band. His band's good. He's got people coming after him.
That's not what we're trying to achieve.
What y'all doing this weekend?
We're just trying to have a little fun.
What's your band doing this weekend?
We're not getting together.
How about next?
I don't think we're getting together.
You got
together.
An open calendar 3 weeks from now?
I think we do.
I'm sure you're playing the next 3 weeks. See, Statesville.
He's a professional, though.
He's traveling.
He's a professional musician. We're just scrubby old dudes trying to have a little fun.
Back to your band.
Back to the band. So we found another place that would take us on. They're in Morganton. And so they said that we can come
take on. Take you on.
Take us on.
That's awesome.
Because it's open mic night. And so it's a Wednesday. So if you want to come join us, I think we're going tomorrow. Wednesday night, Morganton. You can catch a ride with us.
There's no way I'm catching a ride with y'all.
What are you talking about?
You go home at 4 a.m. That's it. Listen.
Not on Wednesday.
That's how you trap people in. Just jump in the car with us. I'll get you back home, bro. No, you won't.
Yeah, well, your wife will see you at 5 o'clock in the morning.
Yeah, really?
Yeah. But
anyway. Where is this open mic? Is it
some little bar.
Chuck E. Cheese kind of deal?
It might be, yeah. I can't remember the name of this place. It's probably kind of like Chuck E. Cheese. But anyway, they said there were four other performers that performed last Wednesday. I wasn't able to attend, and one of them dressed up like a Tin Man, and so they were doing like robot moves and like a robot kind of rap. So that's what we're up against here. So I'm hoping we can bring the house down.
This sounds like a really interesting open mic night.
I think you might want to come check it out. There might have been some dude reading poetry. You know, we're up against them. So I think we might be able to hold our own against them.
You could probably get a
crap.
Frappuccino there. You know, it's like one of those things.
Yeah,
maybe a guy comes up with a violin.
Yeah, come check it out with us, man. Or if y'all want to check it out, I don't know the name of the place, but just Google Open Mic Night Morganton, right?
Right.
And see what y'all can find out. We'll be there on Wednesday.
Is it at Catawba?
Somewhere in Morganton.
Listen, you got to. If you're gonna bring in details, let's bring in details.
That's all I got. That's all I got for you.
Right,
poetry and violin.
I'm not helping you.
Open mic nights. Last Tuesday, you know, a week ago. I'm going to bring up something that truly affected me deeply. So as we've talked here before, I'm a big sports fan. I'm an NC State fan. And I had the opportunity, which was very kind of some people that were Carolina fans, to say, hey, Chad, we got an extra ticket.
We're kind people.
Yeah. Because you were a Carolina fan?
Yep.
Yes. Thank you for letting the audience know. That's why you're a prick. All right. So anyway, these people gave me, they were nice enough to say, Chad, come ride with us. So it, imagine this van. This van came to pick us up at the
bus.
It's a bus. Yeah, it's not really a van. It's a bus. And in the middle of the bus is a full-fledged stripper pole right in the heart of the bus, you know.
Maybe they're firefighters.
Maybe so. I didn't question it. They're Carolina fans. I don't know what they do in their spare time. Okay. But that's the transportation we had. Two state fans, 10 Carolina fans. We travel down Interstate 40 on our way to Chapel Hill, stop in a little place in Durham. Did we stop in Durham? No, Carrboro. Armadillo Grill. Ever been there? Pretty good. Pretty tasty food. Have a couple of cervezas and whatever else we do before we get in there. So by the time the game starts at 8, we get in there about 7:45.
Can I ask you a question?
Please.
What is the ratio, like, bottle to air that is going on your way down there?
Man.
Because I know you're a bottle, like a,
yes,
a bottle guy, big bottle guy.
Yep. So this is what we saw down there. There was some fireball sightings. Not the little pint size, the little airplane bottles. We got fifth size fireball. Multiple bourbon bottles, because a lot of the dudes that went are hunters and they like bourbon.
They want to stay warm.
They want to stay warm in the cold winter. Saw some whiskey. There's a half gallon of Tito's was there. So a lot of that kind of.
Right.
And so we made an effort to really dive deep on our way down there.
Okay.
So we get down there, 7:45, and, you know, we're all been enjoying ourselves. And so I'm pretty riled up right now. I'm pretty fired up. We're going to the State Carolina game. There's a lot of energy in
here. In the Dean Dome. Wearing red?
This is the big part of the story. I wore a black shirt with a red belt and a pair of jeans. So I didn't want to be conspicuous.
You're a state fan. That points out you're a state fan.
But I didn't want to be red and have a Wolfpack hat on or thing on and pom-poms. I wanted to be kind of cool. And so we had really good seats. Probably
everybody together?
No. So we split up. We had 12 of us. We split up in three groups of four. And I happened to be with a group of three Carolina fans and just me, which were real cool dudes. I didn't mind. It was awesome. But the thing was, when we walk into the aisle where we're sitting, I noticed four, I'd say 23 or 24-year-old punks immediately behind us. And they look at me like they wanted
it's on.
You know, they wanted to start a little static. They were trying to get a rise out of me. I could just tell by looking at them, like they were, as soon as I walked down there, I'm first in line. So I sit down and I happen to be right in front of the last dude. Okay.
Right.
And so as soon as I sit down, they start talking about how much Carolina is better than state, just in everything. We're so much smarter. And they're trying just to get a rise out of me.
Right.
And so Hank, I do a simple, like one of these, you know, which is I'm turning around just looking at them. Not say anything, and then I turn back around. I don't say a word.
Fatal move.
So
acknowledging them.
I should have never even
ignored them.
Everybody
knows this.
Exactly. So the game starts, and State's kind of in it. It's like 8-8. We're right in the game, and I'm giving a couple.
8-8, you're right in the game.
I'm giving a couple, just a little claps like that. No, rah, just a. Well, then it starts getting a little hairy.
A little chippy.
12-8, 14-8. 18-8, 26-8. Now here they come.
Chirping.
Here they come in my ear. Relentless. So it's coming out of the right side from this group over here. Then the left side all feel like they're coming on top of me. And so my buddies, the Carolina fans, were like, whoa, man, they're really coming hard at you right now. I'm like, yeah, dude, exactly. I'm trying to be cool. Am I being cool? And they're like, you're being cool. Just stay cool.
Keep you cool.
So when Carolina gets up by 30 at this point, now they're basically throwing popcorns like flying over my head. They're taking their knee, hitting in the back of my chair. I can't take it anymore.
Right.
So Jake, one of my buddies that were with me, they move seats. So they're beside me. And so they're even looking back at the people like, dude, you're embarrassing. Calm down, you know, right. Relax, calm down. Well, I can't take it anymore. So I get up and stand up and look at all of them just – because, you know, I'm big and bold and manly.
Enforcer.
The enforcer's here. And just like all kind of stare at them. I need to leave anyway because I've been sipping on Crown while I've been sitting in the chairs.
Yeah.
And so there's 12 minutes left in the second half. And I just happened
to walk out of the game.
So you gave him the hairy eyeball.
I gave him the, I should have just punched him, but I can't punch anybody. I give him the look. Then I walk out, and the funniest thing is, I don't know. I just want to get out of there. When I'm walking up the aisle, I see two more State fans. We walk out together. They probably were encountering the same similar situation.
Sure. Sure.
So we walk out at the exact same time. We get out, and a couple guys had already left the game, and they were at the van waiting anyway. So it worked out okay. But what do you do in a situation like that? You're in enemy territory, and you're being cool, but these dudes want you to do something.
Right.
Do you stay cool? Do you punch them?
You have to.
Do you pour your drink on their head? What do you do?
You have to. And it's not even about being manly or doing whatever.
Right.
You got too much to lose.
That's very true.
21-year-old doesn't have anything to lose.
Yes.
They don't even care. He probably has a record, right?
Yes.
What's the goal? They're probably egging you out. I hope he punches me. I'll sue him.
Probably,
you know?
So,
I mean, to me, I could care less about people hammering me like that.
Do you know what they were wearing? Imagine what these 23-year-old punks.
I'll paint a picture. Was it cold?
It's cold.
Okay. They're probably wearing khaki pants.
Yes.
They're probably wearing Sperry shoes.
Yes, absolutely.
They're wearing a baby blue collared shirt underneath their Patagonia snap tee.
Bingo.
They had their Costas on their head underneath a visor, and they had a bald spot on the back.
What a picture you paint. So three of the four did. The other one had a shirt, you know, like a button-down shirt that had a pattern, and then the Carolina blue sweater
tied
around the neck with the Costas, the sunglasses up on top of their head. So just looking at it, but you want to punch them just for looking like
that's
that,
just,
you
that's
know?
That's just a 22-year-old.
That's exactly. That's 22-year-old punk. But
that's just a 22-year-old. Listen, I'm a Carolina fan, and I'm not defending them, but, you know, you go some places, and it gets hostile.
Yeah.
You go watch a Giants game and try to wear an Eagles jersey.
Oh, forget. You get killed.
You get killed.
My brother, I'm going to tell a quick story about my brother-in-law is a Baltimore Raven fan.
Yeah, he got the Nutcracker. Did he enjoy it?
What are you talking about?
You got him a Baltimore Raven Nutcracker.
Actually, he really did like that Nutcracker.
Fantastic.
Yes. So anyway, we're at a Jacksonville. Why am I at a Jacksonville-Baltimore game? I have no idea, but we're in Jacksonville. And Jacksonville, I don't know if you're very familiar with the area, but there's a rowdy crowd, and there's a lot of motorcycle gangs in Jacksonville, okay?
Who would have thought they liked football?
Yes, who would have thought that? Anyway, we're at the game, and I'm like, Todd, because my brother-in-law has been known to have a loud mouth, especially after 48 Miller Lights, and he just talks a lot of trash.
Right.
And he's a real tall dude, and I guess maybe he thinks he can get away with it, but we're in enemy territory. He's got a Baltimore Ravens jersey on the whole nine. He's probably about 18 deep for this 1 o'clock Sunday game. Not too many people in the crowd, but I look over to my right, and there's my motorcycle gang group of fellas over there to the right. By the second quarter, Todd is in full just yap, 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 yap to them, and I'm like, dude, listen, I love you and all, but if they start coming over here, I am out because they will kill us, you know?
Yeah.
So keep your mouth shut. Let's just get through this game. Luckily, our wives weren't there. So halftime goes, and they second half, they weren't back yet. Third quarter, you know, the motorcycle gang went there. So Todd was feeling frisky again. Sure enough, here they come. I just said, Todd, let's leave. I got them. We just got the hell out of there because if we would have probably stayed five more minutes, like a brass knuckle would have popped, you know, flown over the stands and popped him right in the face or something, or a nunchuck or a Chinese star. Who knows? But
you might have been pulled into, you know, male slavery.
You never know.
They might have sold you.
Exactly. I mean, I would go for a pretty penny, too, I would guess.
Who knows about that?
What do you think? But anyway, so I guess the proper etiquette when you're in enemy territory, kind of keep your mouth shut. Don't bring any attention to yourself and just get through the game.
Hey, if it gets to that point, you got to defend, but certainly don't get aggressive.
Yes. You know, don't be the instigator.
Heck no.
Yeah. Well, anyway, that ride back home, the bad part was us getting beat by 26 or whatever, but we finished off the rest of all the fun stuff, and we got home at a decent hour. I guess maybe about 1 o'clock in the morning on a Tuesday.
A decent hour.
For the game. We had a long trip.
That's the difference between me and you. A decent hour. About 1 o'clock.
Yeah,
it's early. I bet you stayed up.
I did. Actually, I made a couple phone calls when I got home. I talked to some of my homeboys. I probably went to bed about 2:30.
Yeah.
Tuesday night.
Tuesday night.
Typical Tuesday.
Good work.
Thank you. Anything else on our – I know we've got one other thing on our list to talk about. So this past weekend we had the Hickory Museum of Art Gala, the 75th anniversary of the Hickory Museum of Art, which – turned out to be just a wonderful evening.
It was.
Did you enjoy yourself?
I did, you know. Got to see all you people.
Yeah.
To, you know, act like we were sophisticated.
Yes. We were dressed in tuxedos.
Dressed in tuxedos. Do you know what I thought was hilarious when I got into the art museum?
Yes.
You know, it's a time to celebrate the art museum. And I look around, and knowing the crowd that's going to be there, they have pulled off all the paintings in the art museum because they know there's going to be wine thrown around.
Yeah, no sculptures to be tipped over anywhere to be seen. No. They move all the fine art out of the way of the dance floor.
It was out of the room.
Yeah.
And they had little pictures of the art that was there. And they were like, come back and see it because it's here and it's really nice. It's
hilarious.
But you know, it was funny because, you know, there was some finger food and, you know, there was open bars. There were bars. And, and then, you know, the music started. And you could have been first, second, third out there. I can't remember.
Well, I was first, and then I realized I didn't have my good dancing shoes on. I don't know if you know this, but I carry a pair of dancing shoes.
When you brought shoes with you?
Yes. So I have. Well, they're my go-to dancing shoes.
Can I say something?
Please.
I've lost all respect for you.
Look, I'm a dancer, dude. Everywhere I go, I'm expected to dance, so I've got to have my best dancing shoes with me.
Who expects this?
Dude, come on.
Your fans?
Yes, come on. We know who they are. If y'all want to text me right now, you'll hear this phone blowing up here in a second. Text.
We're not live.
Oh, yes, that's right. But anyway, so I was on the floor. The music comes on, and it was DJ Joe Bunn, this DJ from Chapel Hill. When I was at school at NC State, he would come to Raleigh and perform. He's just awesome DJ. So I go to the car, get my shoes, bring them back. So I'm probably about third on the floor. Third on the floor, yeah.
Yeah, I saw you out there early. And then, you know, my wife, she hones in on it. She got out there quick.
She's a dancer.
She got out there quick. And then I came out a little bit later on.
Saw you out there.
Yep. So it was fun, man.
I noticed there are a few of our friends that never get on the dance floor.
Yeah, and listen, I'm not judging them.
Of course not.
It's how comfortable you feel out there.
Yeah.
It's how comfortable you feel. And, you know, I mean, my thing is you want to dance. You want to be out there from start to finish.
I love it.
Yeah, you want to be out there from start to finish.
Yeah.
I like dancing. I just don't like 4 hours of dancing, right? I mean, right. Can I have a drink, sit over there, talk to somebody, maybe come in, dance a couple songs, then get out.
Sure.
Then drink a drink, and then come in, give a high five.
Yeah.
And maybe grab a date wrapped in bacon, I don't know, and then head back out there.
Yeah.
That's kind of my deal.
Yeah.
But like Reagan, she's like you. Like anytime I try to make a break for it, she's like, it's only been five songs.
Right, come
on. I'm like, I know I need a headband. And I'm sweating to death.
I was a sweaty mess out there. I remember giving Michael Banks a hug, and he was like, God dang. Because, I mean, I was completely filled with sweat. My entire shirt was sweaty.
Yeah.
Head sweaty. I needed a headband, too. But anyway, it was a great, great night. And I think there's another – the Heartball is coming up. So it's another tuxedo event that you could dance at. Will you be there?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. I'll be there, too. So we've got that to look forward to. And then this weekend, anything special going on in Hickory, Hank? Anything going on with you? No All-Star games. No sport. You got your baseball stuff going on, which, by the way, how's it going?
It's going well. You know, I mean, it's just so funny to watch. And this is just sports in general. You know, these 9-year-old kids, 10-year-old kids, they're learning stuff that I didn't learn until junior high or high school.
Hmm.
You know, I mean, just like, it's just, you have so much time with them, and they've done, it's just kind of interesting how it, like, kind of evolves. But it also points out how kids get burnt out.
Sure.
You know what I mean? Like, so, like, just this baseball team in general, we're working on pickoff moves and at 9.
Wow.
You know, that doesn't, you know, that's not, I didn't learn that till middle school.
Sure.
Right?
Yeah.
So, I mean, it's kind of interesting to just kind of see that evolution, but it really comes down to no pressure situations. You know, we're not, I tell people all the time, is like, I'm not trying to make the best 9-year-old. You know, I'm just trying to have a 9-year-old have fun and hopefully fundamentally be good when he's in high school.
Yeah.
Not great. I'm not trying to build an MLB star.
Right.
Just enjoy the sport enough.
Have a good time.
To want to play it and want to get better.
Sure.
You know, I mean, that's part of it is, and you know, I think the thing is with kids and working out, like figuring out, is kids don't want to put in the time because they think of time as these huge chunks. And I've sold Harris on the fact that, you know, you want to go hit. And he was like, he used to be like, I don't want to go. We go, and I'm like, it's only going to take us 45 minutes.
Yeah.
And we'll go, we'll hit for 45 minutes, he's back, he can play some Fortnite. You know, he's yeah. Now it's always like, yeah, I'll go hit, let's hit. It's a short period of time. Mm-hmm. And so if you get him to figure out that, it ain't that long.
Right.
You know, it ain't that, you know, let's just do something to get a little bit better.
Yeah. And he's passionate about the sport, the sports too, right?
Yeah, he loves it all.
Yeah. Yeah, so that helps a lot too. Yeah, I was talking to one daddy, that his kids are in fourth grade, and he said he already has his kids honed into one sport. That's how they're going to play. I'm like, I was like, you know, they're only in – actually, they're not even in fourth grade. They're in second grade.
That's ridiculous.
And I'm like, come on, man. Let them play all these other sports. He was like, no, they really don't want to. I'm like, man, they probably do. But anyway, that's a story for another time.
That second grader could be 6'8", 300.
Yes.
He could be 5'1",
right.
110.
Right.
I mean, what you're pitching
Let
on
them play them all.
Let them do it all.
Figure out what they like to do. Let's
be a concert violinist. Who knows?
You never know. You never know. But anyway, Hank, good having you back in the studio.
Appreciate it.
Yeah,
glad to be here. I'm glad to see you. It was fun spending some time with you this weekend at the until the first note hit, you were gone.
See ya. Yes. I just love to dance, Hank. I just love to dance. So we'll end it with this one. We're going to be back in 2 weeks. We never really got to talk about it. Did you win any Super Bowl bets? We didn't get to talk about
that. I won a ton of Super Bowl bets.
Did you really? And all the ones I talked about wanting to bet, I ended up not even betting.
I won a ton. Golly. Prop bets. I took, like, the Brady's yardage and the over. I took the over on the national anthem,
which was the lock of the year.
Coin flip.
Yeah.
Gronk receptions.
Man, you did have a good day.
Second half Patriots.
Wow.
Patriots for the game. I mean, it was a special night. It would have really been special if I'm more of a man and would bet more than $5 at a time.
It's still fun, though.
But it was just fun.
Well, congratulations to
How
you,
How about
buddy.
You? Did you?
Yeah, not too good. We traveled kind of not far away, but 20 minutes away driving for the Super Bowl. And so we left at halftime. When you got to leave in the middle of the party, I can never really fully get into it, fully vested into the Super Bowl. Yeah. I want to be at a spot where I'm there for the whole shebang. What did you think about the halftime show?
Didn't even watch it.
Did you not?
No, I didn't care for it.
I watched it, and I was thoroughly disappointed.
Yeah, I didn't want to
Did not
watch.
Think it was very good at
yeah,
all.
I was trying to make some nachos or something.
You're good at that. All right, guys. Until next two weeks from now, this is Hank and Chad signing off of The Big Fan. Peace.
You've been listening to The Mesh, an online media network of shows and programs ranging from business to arts, sports to entertainment, music to community. All programs are available on the website as well as through iTunes and YouTube. Check us out online at themesh.tv. Discover other network shows and give us feedback on what you just heard.